A great and mighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus, our God and our Captain, the Lord of our battle, our great Commissioner, our Master and Lord, our Father full of love. How great you are, Lord, and how wonderful it is to know you, to walk this pathway with you by our side. Thank you, Lord, since the day we met you, since the day you called us, since the day you chose us and brought us to yourself, it's been wonderful. Traveling this way along with you, it's been a great and exciting experience. Having you by our side, giving us assurance every step of the way. We thank you, Lord, because we set our feet on the road of the Lord. We made up our minds that our decision was a decision of never to go back. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for you have not disappointed us. We can say, with the benefit of many years of walking with you, with the benefit of many years of serving you, with the benefit of many years of being your servants, we can say, you have not disappointed. And Lord, we count it a great privilege. We are greatly indebted to you, Lord, for choosing us and calling us. We who are ordinary people, useless people in the world, no people who have nothing, no nobility, nothing that makes us special, but you called us. Your grace chose us and made us what we are today. Great, mighty God, whatever we are today, Lord, it's not because of what we have done, it's a testimony of your greatness. Wherever we have made progress, Lord, it is not because of what we have done, it is a testimony of your faithfulness. Whatever success we have had, it is not because of what we have done, it is a testimony of your sovereignty. And Father, we worship you, Lord. Accept our thanks tonight in Jesus' name. All we've been able to do since the beginning of the year, since the last time we gathered together like this, when we look back at all those things, there is only one way we can sum it up all, and that is, you have been a faithful God. We have never known you to lie. We have never known you to disappoint. We have never known you to fail. We have never known you to falter. Great, mighty God, I will bless your holy name tonight, that we are gathered together here before your presence, and that we feel the presence of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost right here tonight. How we thank you, because we know the angels of God are gathered. In our meeting tonight, we are not gathered unto vanity. We are gathered unto the holy assembly. We are gathered to the spirits of just men made perfect. We are gathered in this holy mountain, and we have come to be changed. We have come to be challenged. We have come to be envisioned. We have come to be enlightened. We have come to be helped. We have come to be lifted up. And Lord, we can sense this, the pulsating power of the Holy Ghost here already. How I pray, Father, nobody here will miss that power of the Lord in Jesus' name. Amen. From this very moment, even here now, begin to stretch forth your hand and begin to touch us where we need your touch. Begin to strengthen us where we need your strength. Begin to renew us where we are weak. Begin to restore us where we are strayed. Begin to empower us where we are weak. Lord, I want to pray that your multifarious, multifaceted hand will go right into the hand out of everybody. And you will do something great, something definite and spectacular. Something we'll never forget. Something that will be written indelibly in our hearts and lives. Even in everybody tonight, in Jesus' name. We knew all the time we were planning this program that you were going to be here. We sensed your potent power all along. We could feel it even in all the planning, in all the praying, in all the consultations, and in how you have given us favor, in all the places we have made contact with people. We've all arrived at this one single conclusion, that you have been aiming at this weekend to do something great and marvelous in our lives. Lord, whatever we beat back the cloud of the Lord, whatever we beat back the power of the Lord, whatever we beat back the move of God, whatever we beat back the revelation of the glory of the Lord, whatever we beat back the manifestation of the grace of God, whatever we push back the move of the Spirit and of the grace of the Lord in our lives tonight and this weekend, Almighty God, we pray, blow that thing back out of the way in Jesus' name. How we pray that your power will flow unhindered. Your grace will flow unhindered. Your glory will flow unhindered. Your majesty, your glory, your power, your mighty, gracious move. Like on the day of Pentecost. Like in the days gone by, in the days of our forefathers. Like in the days of our people who have gone before us. Whatever will stop the move of the Spirit here in this place. Lord, we pray, you will beat it back speedily in Jesus' name. The circumstance around us, the atmosphere around us, the very air around us, the glory of God around us, This is the conducive kind of weather we need for to be touched by you. And so, Lord, we lay ourselves bare before you. We open our hearts and our minds and our souls. We acknowledge the fact that we are weak. We acknowledge the fact that we are tired. We acknowledge the fact that we need some refinement. Lord, we bring our gold mixed with all sorts of alloys. And we want you to dip our gold in the Pentecostal fire, in the fire of the Holy Ghost. And you'll purge all the dross out of us. And we shall leave this place hereafter as refined gold and purified and ready for service in Jesus' name. Touch man and woman. Touch leaders and followers. Touch preachers and invitees. Touch everybody where we need you. Let us know right from tonight that your presence is in our midst. Thank you, Lord, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We give glory to the name of the Lord for seeing us to the very beginning of this momentous conference. As we gather together these 4 days, we need to understand the fact that we've not been gathering like this in this place before. And yet, we need to understand that we have been gathering like this before. The problem which people have whenever they are dealing with God is the problem of familiarity. The fact that the way God has always been, and because the scripture says that God doesn't change, the same yesterday, today, and forever, human beings are wont, they are prone to taking God for granted, thinking that because God doesn't change, therefore, the workings of God do not change. And yet we need to understand that even though we've been gathering like this before, we need to know that this is a gathering of a different kind. And the Holy Ghost and God himself and his son Jesus will be so gracious to us these 4 days that by the time we leave this place, we will not leave as we came in Jesus' name. But if that's going to happen, we all need to concentrate and cooperate with the Lord for to do all that his mind and his counsel has purposed to do, so that we will not hinder the gracious move that God has planned and proposed these 4 days. We believe in God that as we gather together these 4 days, the things that God is going to do in our lives will go beyond this program, go beyond this year, go beyond this region, go beyond this city, go into all the nooks and crannies where there are souls of men, and wherever there is deeper life work in this region, how we pray that like the leaven that was put in a bushel of meal, of flour, and it leavened the whole thing, that we will be sent forth by God from this place and leaven the whole region with the power and the grace of God in Jesus' name. Tonight, we are talking on the impetus, because you will see on your program, you will see the session actually, this is a call, the center, the signal of the whole program, the program that we have every night, the last program of the night, that is titled The Impetus. And tonight, we're starting with the first message, Forward. And as we are led of the Lord, you will see some things already in the outline in your hand. I'll be talking on those things, and I'll also be talking on things outside the outline in your hand. We put files in your hands, we'll put play sheets for you to make notes, so that you'll write down all your consecrations, all the word of God that God has touched you with, all the things that I am sure that God is going to minister to you, because he has prepared all our ministers specially, spectacularly, and we are going to see what I'm saying from now onwards until the end of the program. So we put all those things in your hand to be able to get down the notes, everything, and also put down your consecrations, and also be able to pray. And thank God the environment is so conducive, is the kind of place where God moves, and I believe God, he will move this week in Jesus' name. So tonight, we're talking on the manifesto of Impetus 92, Forward. In 1991 October, we convened together, and we were at the Consolidation 91, that time. There we were made to see by God, by the Holy Ghost, how the great need was for us as a church to consolidate, that there was a necessity laid upon us as a church to strengthen our grips. And if you go through all the program of the last consolidation, you will see the great emphasis we laid on strengthening our grips on a number of areas of our lives. One, strengthening our grips on our personal lives. And the emphasis then was that if you are going to be a Christian worker, you cannot allow your Christian life, personal life, to drift. And you cannot be loose. You cannot afford to grow mental, spiritual flabbiness. And that by all means and at all costs, whatever God will need to do, he had to do, so that our personal lives will lose all the mental flab, all the useless fat that makes our spiritual lives to be hindered and that makes progress difficult. And we're able to see why we needed to strengthen our grips on our leadership styles And so you will notice last the program where if you were there, we had what we call leadership training studies. Why we had to see the need to strengthen our grips, that is, to tighten our belt in terms of leadership in the church. We were also able to see the need to strengthen our grips on the church life. And so you had messages like contending for the faith. We had messages like the believer's life. We had messages like treasure in hardened vessels. We had many, all those great, great things that God spoke to us, all to the intent that we needed to strengthen our grips on our personal life, on our leadership style, on the church life, and above all, the great need to strengthen our grips on our call and commission, to visit once again, to reevaluate once again, to look into it once again, our call and commission to evangelize this region. And so you will notice in that program, we had a whole session dedicated to evangelism. And we talked about the mandate God has given to us. We talked about our unfinished task. We talked about all those things had to do with our evangelization program for the whole region. Because upon us, upon our obedience or disobedience, upon our zeal or coldness, upon our faithfulness or unfaithfulness, hangs the faith of thousands of people in this region. If we don't go to them, they won't come to us. They will perish while they are in darkness, and we will be sitting down while we are in the light. And so it depends on us. What happens to thousands of souls? The fate of thousands of souls hangs upon your head, upon my head. When you realize that, when that vision is living with you all the time, you will not allow your Christian life, your commitment, your call, your consecration to just drift anyhow. Because you know that if you are unfaithful to that calling, thousands of souls will perish as a result of your unfaithfulness. And so we're able to talk about all those things. And we left the Congress that time, last October, with our heart touched by God and with renewed determination to contend for the faith once delivered to the saints. And we thank God because of testimonies and for progress that have been made thus far. But this year and this time, the Congress is a momentous one. And like as I said in the prayer, throughout the time of preparation of this program, we felt and sensed the latent, unexpressed move of the Holy Ghost. There was a tingling sensation of the possibility of what God is going to do. And because I felt that sensation and that latent move of the Holy Ghost in a quiet, subtle manner, even all the time of preparation, that was why I called all the workers in the central, in the church here in the town, and I said, we have to have prayer meeting. And for 2 Wednesdays now, we had fasting and prayer just for this program. And we came together to pray because I sensed that God wanted to do something. And even now as I'm talking, I still sense. And I still have that it has not left me that God wants to do something momentous in our lives this week. How I pray that nothing outside us, nothing inside us will hinder the move of the Lord in Jesus' name. Because you know, this very hour and this time, God wants to start something among us. Generally in programs, the first message of the first night, they call it introduction. But tonight, as you can see, there's no introduction. Because already we are in the impetus already. And we are moving forward already. And we have sung it in our song that our God is marching on. And I dare tell you, it's a disastrous thing to stand still when God is moving. It's a dangerous thing to remain seated when God is blowing and moving forward. That was the problem that young prophet had. God said, deliver your prophecy back there in the land of Samaria. And after you have finished the message, keep on moving. Because I, God, I am moving. There's no stopping. Don't go by the same way you came because there's no retreat. There's no tracing back your steps. Go by another way because God is always on the move. And God said, deliver your prophecy and keep on moving. And he delivered the prophecy. He kept on moving. But then he got to a point. He sat down and that was where disaster met him. It's a dangerous thing to stop when God is moving. And you can see the logo of the program is a dove that is in flight. You can see it on the file. You can see it on the program. It's a dove symbolizing the Holy Ghost, the third person of the Trinity. And where the Holy Ghost is, the Father is there, the Son is there. And so, you see the Spirit of the Lord symbolized by that dove moving forward. Moving. It's not a static dove. It's not a dove that is perching on something. It's not a dove that is seated. It's not a dove that is sleeping. And it's not a dove that is just having a nice time. It's a dove in flight. And God is marching on. And that's why I plead with you days for days to move because God is moving. And I pray that as many of us as move with God, God will carry us to great heights that we have never known before in Jesus' name. We call the program Impetus 92. The word impetus, maybe some of us might not have taken time to check it out, what it means. But we have helped you to put it here. The word impetus actually is a descriptive noun. It's a noun that describes something. And it is a word that is associated with movement, with progress, with dynamism. Impetus, whenever you hear that word, it's not talking about static. It's not talking about something stationary. It's not talking about something passive. It's not something about something in a moment of inertia. It's talking about something on the move. Talking about progress. Talking about movement and dynamism. And this is talking about the force with which a body moves. Actually, that's the description. That's the meaning of impetus. It is the force with which a body moves. Forward. And this is what we are praying for. This is what we are asking for. That this propelling force that pushes a body forward will be present in our midst these 4 days. This is in the prayer in our heart, in my heart. And I've been praying all these many days that God will transfer that prayer from my heart to my lips. And I thank God He did. And I'm praying that God will transfer that prayer from your heart to your lips also. That the Holy Ghost will make that prayer in our heart to come up out of our lips. So that the good Lord will move this local body of Christ, this church, this body represented here today, that God will move us forward. That's our prayer. That in this Congress, God the Father, by the agency of His Holy Spirit, will give us an impetus, will give us a powerful moving force, will propel us forward as a church, and as a whole region, it will make us to go forward from where we are presently in Jesus' name. And when that happens, I pray it will happen today. When that happens, what happens? The only result of that movement, of that force, of that pushing, the only result of that propelling power of the Holy Ghost upon us as a church, as a region, the only result is this, is that all those of us who are assembled in all this place, these 4 days, we will go forward in all aspects of spiritual endeavor. We'll go forward in holy living. We'll go forward in conformity unto the image of Jesus Christ. We'll go forward in our prayer lives, our prayer ministry. We'll go forward into the regions of darkness where there are souls that are bound by the devil, and we'll pluck them out from Satan's jaws. We'll go forward to pluck these weak people, helpless people who don't know their left from their right, like the people of Nineveh. We'll go forward to them and show them the light of the gospel. And we'll tell them that Jesus still saves today. Jesus still delivers today. Jesus still sets free today. All the captives of the devil. When that happens, what will happen is that all of us will go forward in personal attainment. We'll go forward, not only that, in gifts and in graces. And you look at all the program, that's how it's been planned. Look at all the seminars, look at all the workshops, the only overriding passion, the only great desire, the expressed wish in the heart of God is that we all go forward in gifts and in grace. That we go forward in our fitness for the work, in our hands. We are not gathered because we want to have a banquet. We are not gathered because we are doing a celebration. We're not gathered because of there's a festival in town. We are gathered because there's a work in our hands. There's an immortal work in our hands given us by God. We were mortal men. There's a work given us by God. We were sinners, saved by grace, brought into the light, now given the gospel message to take to sinners and wicked people like we were. We are given a work that our natural wisdom, our normal powers, our abilities as ordinary human beings, we are given a work that our powers and abilities cannot cope with. And that's why we are gathered together, because we realize more than ever before our inefficiency, our inadequacy, our inability to do this work, except God helps us. That's the crying prayer in the heart of the Holy Ghost. And in our hearts, do this 4 days, that as we are gathered together, the work of the Lord in our hands will go forward by leaps and by bounds. And so now, when God moves, when God answers our prayer, we'll go forward even in fitness for our work. We discover a lot of unfitness in our lives. We discover a lot of inadequacy in our lives. We discover a lot of things required by the work, but absent in us. And yet, God will not send angels down to do it. And yet, Jesus will not come down the second time to do it. And yet, the apostles of old who have died and they have gone to their reward, they will not come back to come and do it again. If we fail, God fails. Because God has no other method. We are God's method. And we are the people to whom God has given the world. And unless God helps us and feeds us for the world, we are weak people, powerless people in the face of a dying generation. And so when God answers that prayer, and I pray we answer it tonight, we'll move forward in every good work. And when we have been kindled by the Holy Ghost like this, when we have been set on fire, when we have been kindled by the fire from heaven above, from the throne of God, we all will go together like Samson's foxes. In Judges chapter 15, the Bible tells us about what Samson did and how he sent his incendiaries into the fields of the enemy. And we are told in Judges chapter 15 verse 3, and Samson said concerning them, "Now shall I be more blameless than the Philistines, though I do them a displeasure?" And Samson went and caught 300 foxes and took firebrands and turned tail to tail and put a firebrand in the midst between the two tails. And when he has set the brand on fire, not until then, not just dry, dead, lifeless, fireless foxes, not foxes without the fire in their tails, not foxes without the power in their tails, not foxes without the kindling matter in their tails. After he had set the fire, the brands on fire, he let them go. And this is our prayer, that before God lets us go these 4 days, he would have set our brands on fire. And when we go forth like Samson's foxes, we will set on fire the standing shocks of corn in the land. When Samson set for those foxes, he sent them into the standing shocks of corn of the enemy. And everywhere the foxes went, fire spread there. Everywhere we go after this program, may the fire of the Holy Ghost, may the fire of prayer, may the fire of holiness, may the fire of the zeal of God consuming us like it consumed Jesus. May the fire of faithfulness in service and consecration, may the fire of holiness go along with us. May that fire be spread all over the region and all over the world by our preaching, by our lives, in Jesus' name. And so we will go into the standing shocks of corn and set all of them on fire. All our brethren who are not here, all those who are not qualified, who we didn't invite, and all these people who are waiting back for us, saying, my pastor has gone for impetus, my region overseer has gone for impetus, my district coordinator has gone for impetus, my location pastor has gone for impetus, my zone leader, my area leader has gone for impetus. Let me see what will come out after this impetus they have been shouting about many months now. Let me see what will happen after it. I pray many things will happen. And the fire will go everywhere and will set all of them on fire. We shall kindle the fire of God's indignation, God's power, God's wrath against every unrighteousness in our locations. We shall be compelled. No, we shall be impassioned. We shall be really propelled to fill the land with the glorious gospel of our Lord. Thereby, we will fill the kingdom of God with newly saved souls. Oh God, that's our prayer for impetus. And may the Lord hear it and write it down. And may he send a speedy answer upon this body of Christ, waiting before him in faith and expectation of what he's going to do. Therefore, in this keynote address, it's important for me, because of the purpose of our gathering together, it's pertinent for me to challenge you and challenge myself to do only one thing. And that's the title of our message tonight, to go forward. There's no other place to go. In Exodus chapter 14. Exodus chapter 14 and verse 15. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel that they go forward. Here was Moses and about 2 million souls at the front of the Red Sea. Here was a Red Sea not willing to yield. Here were on the left and on the right mountains they could not climb. High mountains. Here was behind them a pursuing enemy asking for their heads of all those 2 million people. Here was a group of people hemmed in on every side, on the left, on the right, on the front and behind. And there was no other place to go except perhaps jump into the water and drown. And these people began to cry. And these people began to shout, what shall we do? How shall we do? We are in great danger. And the only one thing we can do is to go forward and perish in this water, or else stand still and be destroyed by the enemy, or else climb the mountains and die in the process. What shall we do? And the Lord spoke and said unto Moses, Moses, why are you crying? Why are you wasting your time? Get up. Speak to the people of Israel. Tell them that whatever their circumstance notwithstanding, their condition notwithstanding, their difficulty notwithstanding, the peculiarity of their case notwithstanding, there is only one command I have for you all, Israel, go forward. No other place. And brethren, that's the only one option we have. The only place we can go is to go forward. We have received grace from God. We have received a calling from God. We have been chosen by God. The fact that we are saved from sin, the fact that we are chosen by God to be workers together with him in the vineyard is a calling. The fact that we have been chosen to come out of the world of sin and be separated unto God is a calling. The fact that God has saved us and he has put the Holy Ghost in our bosoms and he has given us the word of the Lord, he has put us the privilege of prayer, that is enough to confirm our calling. And therefore we have received grace. And after that, there is only one place we can go, and that is forward. To stand still will be to waste that grace of God that has been given to us. To go back will be to fall short of that grace of God that has been given to us. Only one option. We cannot go forward, backward. We cannot go to the left or to the right. We can only go forward. That's why we are here. We are here to go forward. We are here to make progress. And we have only one place to go. The bitter complaint, the complaint of God, the complaint of the Almighty, the grouse that the Almighty had to settle, the axe that the Almighty God had to grind with the thousands of Judah. The problem that the Almighty God had with the thousands, the elders of Judah, was because of this problem of going forward. In Jeremiah chapter 7. Jeremiah chapter 7. Reading there from verse 24. When God sent the prophet Jeremiah to his people, there was only one message, summarizing all the message that the prophet gave to the people of Israel. Only one thing, and this is it. But they hearken not, nor incline their ear, but walked in the counsels and in the imagination of their evil hearts, and went backward. They went backward. They went backward, and not forward. When they left Egypt, it was forward. When they got to the Red Sea, it was forward. When they got to Jericho, the call was still forward. The wall will come down. When they came against the Gibeonites, the call was still forward. When they were destroying the Canaanites, the Amorites and the Girgashites, the call was still forward. In the days of Moses, the call was still forward. In the days of Joshua, the call was still forward. But there rose up a new set of leaders after Joshua died who knew not the Lord. And since that time, the Bible says, until the time of Jeremiah, hundreds of years later, they went backward and not forward. And that was the grouse. That was the problem that God had to settle. That was what annoyed God about all these people, the people of Israel. They went backward and they did not go forward. Should not this drive us? Should not this urge us? Should not this press us to go forward toward the mark of the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus? Shall we copy them and be like them? People who are not going forward but backward? Oh, but I can hear you say, but they make progress. In the days of the prophets, Isaiah, they make progress. In the days of King Hezekiah, they make progress. In the days of Samuel, they make progress. Yes, they did. But their progress was one step forward, three steps backward. They make progress, a step forward, and three steps backward. And that was why God said in the days of Jeremiah that these people, they went backward and not forward. They could have argued and said, God, we are going forward. In the days of Samuel, we went forward. We kept the Passover. In the days of Hezekiah, we kept the Passover. We built the temple of the Lord in the days of Solomon. What do you mean we are not going forward? Oh, yes, you are going forward. But when you take a step forward, you take three steps backward. How many of us can identify with that here tonight? How many of us find our lives summarized like this here tonight? That in our Christian experience, in our Christian life, there is only one way to summarize it. That we have been taking a step forward, three steps backward. In our service for the Lord, in our commitment and consecration, we take a step forward, we take three steps backward. In our holiness of life and of heart, we take a step forward when we come for program, when we go for retreat. But thereafter, we take two steps backward. In our preaching, in our soul winning and evangelism, we go a step forward when we are mobilized. But thereafter, we take three steps backward. In our prayer life, are we not like that? We take a step forward. In prayer life, when we hear a charging message, when we hear a more fiery message, when we read a book, or we hear a case, something fiery and powerful and dynamic, we take a step forward. But no sooner had we finished that than we took three steps backward. And God told the elders of Israel, I have a problem with you. You leaders of the people, you are supposed to be captains of the battle. You are supposed to lead the way and show the people how to make progress. I have a problem with you. You are supposed to shine the light for the other people, helpless people, to follow behind you. I have a problem with you. Why is it that you are not going forward? Why is it that you are pressing back and you are not willing to advance? Why are you all the time retreating, retreating, retreating? Oh yes, retreating is good in its own time. Like we are here today, we are retreated here so that we can advance. We have not retreated so that we can sit down. We have not retreated so that we can go into our shells. We are not retreated so that we can weep some tears of pity that God has not been faithful. We are not here. We have not retreated here to look one another in the face, to see the person we've not seen long time ago since December. We are here retreated so that we can be charged, so that we can make progress, and so that we can go forward with renewed power, vigor, and zeal. And God had that problem. He said, we are not going forward. And so then, brothers and sisters, we need to go forward this day. The call of the Spirit of the Lord to the church today, the cry of God, the Father, and of his son Jesus to the church, is this: forward. No backward, no standstill, no going back. Go forward. Go forward in your obedience, for that is the path to greatness. Do you seek to be great? Do you seek to be mighty for God? Do you seek for God to give you a mighty, mighty ministry? Do you seek God to give you a greater dynamism than ever before? Do you seek greatness in any area of your life? Preeminence as a man of prayer? Preeminence as a man of the word, as Apollos? Preeminence as a man of evangelism like Paul? Preeminence as a man of apostolic fervor and zeal like Peter? Do you seek greatness? The part of it is to go forward in obedience. The people who were disobedient yesterday, they were put aside. Now they are on the bookshelf. They have been abandoned by God. They have been put on the shelf. No more. They are not useful for contemporary ministry anymore. Go forward in obedience. For that's the path of greatness. And go forward in sobriety. Or else your words will eat as doth a canker. For Paul was writing to Timothy. He said, their words eat as a canker. In other words, when they talk too much, their word has acidic effect. That boils, that eats something, that destroys. And so go forward in sobriety. Go forward in quietness. Go forward in quietness. We have come here not to be, not to see one another. We have come here not to talk. We have come here not just to see people. We've not come here to just make plans. We've not come here to have conferences around the round table and be formulating strategies alone. We have not come here to see a long forgotten friend, a friend we've seen long time ago. We have not come here to talk. Go forward in sobriety, or else your words will eat as doth a canker. If there is anywhere to go forward in the midst of believers today, if there is a virtue that is in short supply in the church of God today, it is this, the virtue, the power of a quiet life, the power of a sober life, for that is the source of strength. Remember, the Bible says in Isaiah chapter 30 verse 15, in quietness and in confidence shall be your strength. So go forward in sobriety, for that is the way to receive strength from above. Go forward then in holy living. And go forward in conformity to the image of Christ, for that is your credential on the day of resurrection. As we all gather together here, we are gathered for a purpose. And yet there will be a better gathering sometime later in the future. When all the saints of God from all ages, when all the people of God who have served God, all the veterans of God, all the generals of God, all the captains of the battle, all the people in whose steps we are following, when we all shall gather together on that day, and the only credential on that day will not be the great, great works that we have done. The credential on that day will not be the exploits that we have wrought in the world. The credential on that day will not be the evangelism that we have done in the world. The credential on that day will not be all the things that we have achieved in the world. The credential is this: holiness of life, conformity to the image of Jesus Christ within and without. That your internal and external climates, the climate of your heart inside you, the weather, the state of climate in your heart inside you, as well as the environment around you, will reflect nothing but holiness. Will reflect nothing but conformity to the image of Jesus. Go forward therefore in holy living, and go forward in conformity to the image of Christ. For that's your credential. On the day of resurrection, go forward, my brothers and sisters, in self-denial. Because, you know, self-indulgence has slain his thousands, 10,000. Let's fear, let's tremble, lest we perish by the hands of that Delilah. Remember something? It was Delilah and slothfulness that killed him. It was Delilah and slothfulness that shunned him of his power. It was Delilah and self-indulgence that destroyed him. Samson didn't die on the knees of Delilah. Samson died long before he met Delilah. Since the time he started an indulgent life, since the time he started a life lacking in self-denial, since the time he started a life lacking in, you know, putting the flesh and crucifying the flesh, since that time, Samson died. But the final blow was dealt by Delilah. Therefore, let us fear. On the knees of this Delilah of self-indulgence, let us not rest. Let's tremble, because it has killed his 10,000. Remember, the Bible says, our guests are in the gates of hell. Therefore, go forward in self-denial and go forward in faith. Go forward in courage. For to be otherwise, to be unfaithful, to be faithless, to lack courage, is to be a miserable weakling in a world full of adversity. Remember that scripture that says, if thou fail in the day of adversity, thy strength is small. Here is a world in which we are living, a world full of adversity, a world full of evil, a world full of wickedness. And if we are going to go forward in this world of adversity and wickedness, we need to be strong in faith and in courage. If we are going to face the world with the prince of the power of the world, with the devil who seems to have absolute sway in the world, if we are going to have our place in this wicked world, if God is going to make a room for us as a church, if God is going to make a room for you as a pastor, if God is going to make room for you as a district coordinator, here is what you need. You need faith in God and courage. Like God told Joshua, go forward. Go forward. My servant Moses is dead. Yes, enough of funeral song. Let me hear his victory triumph. Enough of funeral rite. Let me see you marching forward. Enough of weeping and mourning over Moses. Let's see you make some progress. Enough of all this just sitting down and mourning your losses. and weeping over your losses. Right now the call of the Spirit is this: you, Joshua, arise and go forward, for you shall bring the people to the land that I promised them, the land that floweth with milk and honey, and you will divide the land for them for an inheritance. Joshua, get up and go forward. We need courage, we need faith. When we meet all the enemies of our faith, we need courage, we need faith. We might have some little discomfort in this program. We need faith and we need courage. We might have to sit down many hours from morning till night just to sink in the word of God and pray. We need faith, we need courage. You might hear some difficult things that you will need the grace of God to obey. You need faith and you need courage. You might have some things coming your way that you didn't understand before, and God is going to shine a new light into your eyes to see that thing, and you will need faith and courage to take those steps. And so therefore, go forward in faith and go forward in courage, for to be otherwise is to be a miserable weakling in a world full of adversity. Go forward in the prayer life. For that is a grace in which several children of God today are defective. Think about it. Go forward in the prayer life. You cannot afford to stand still. You cannot afford to depend on yesterday's prayer life. You cannot afford to depend on the prayer life you had when we were converted 7 years ago. Go forward. That is a grace. That is a virtue in which several children of God are defective. Go forward. Go forward in the prayer life. Pray, for that's your strength. Make constant visits to Gethsemane. Peep into the garden and see your Lord and Master Jesus. See him kneeling down and saying, "Father, not as I will, but as thou will." And he got up again and he saw Peter and the other people. "What? Couldn't you watch with me for 1 hour? Wake up, rise and pray, for the spirit is willing, the flesh is weak, but pray, lest you enter into temptation." And he went back. And he said the same words, "Father, if nothing can be done except that I must drink this cup, I will be done." Make constant visits to Gethsemane. Yonder behind me here is a wood where you can get lost and forget yourself there. And come out of that place like Jacob came out from his night encounter with the angel. A changed man, a prince with God. Get lost in that wood right behind me here from tomorrow morning. Get lost there. Get lost in the bowels of that wood, come out of that place, and wrestle with God there. And then when you are coming out, you are coming out as a prince of God. Get lost there, for that is your strength. When you get lost in that wood, God will locate you where you are. Thank God you are not like Adam, that God will have to be saying, "Where are thou?" The Spirit of God is inside you already. He will tell God where you are. And wherever you are, kneeling down or sitting down or standing up, and you are saying, "God, visit me," that will be your garden of Gethsemane. Visit the place constantly. Go forward in your prayer life. And go forward in consecration. And in commitment to the Lord. Go forward in your disciplined study of scriptures. We are here to learn a lifestyle of Bible study. And all the messages you are going to hear are soaked and saturated with the Bible. Thank God we are not preaching philosophy. Thank God we are not preachers of empty words or rantings of we're ignorant men. Thank God we are not just speaking things that we don't know. We're speaking from the Bible. Thank God that we have a book of reference, the Bible that is an eternal contemporary, that's always working, the Bible that never loses its inspiration and power. Thank God we have a well to draw from that can never run dry. The word of the Lord. Go. And we all who are here, we need to understand that all around us, all over the world, all around us, all over the church, old time altars of consecration are being pulled down, and personal towers of Babel are rising up on the one sacred site. The sacred site where the altar of consecration was before, where offering of God, offering of consecration rose up to the throne of heaven, where God smelled a sweet smelling savor. Those altars have been pulled down, and the sites have been leveled, and personal towers of Babel have been built on it. Historians tell us today that on the site where Solomon's temple was originally built, an Herod's temple was built in Israel, right there on that place now, the temple has been pulled down, and there's a mosque on the side, sacrilege on the side, the enemy on the side, the devil on the side, the seed of Ishmael on the side, where God has reserved for the seed of Abraham, Jesus Christ. But thank God the day is coming when God will come down and thunder mightily and raise that mosque to pieces and raise up his temple once again. Altars of consecration are coming down. And on those places where they were, personal towers of Babel are rising up. And God is calling us today to search our lives and touch your heart and search your life and search my life. And see if our altars of consecration have been pulled down. If towers of Babel have been raised on the side to feed our ego, to make us a name, to gather together and to form a clause and form a caucus and gather under the man or who gathered them together and just settle down instead of scattering all over the world, instead of preaching the gospel all over the place. And he said, let's settle down here. But God says, scatter, go forward, no standing here. You have no resting here. This is not your rest. You cannot rest here. Go forward. And God is telling us tonight that where all those towers of Babel are freezing up, the Lord God is here in power to put down all those towers of Babel and restore the altar of the Lord. At the commission of Gideon, the Bible says that God called Gideon and he said, raise up the altar. And he built the altar unto the Lord. At the call of Elijah, when he was going to call down fire down from heaven, the Bible says, and Elijah drew near and repaired the altar of the Lord. We need to draw near tonight and days for days so that the altar of the Lord in our lives can be built up again, and so that offerings and sacrifices of holiness and of consecration and of prayer and of service and of yieldedness in the hand of God can rise up again, and so God can smell a sweet savor. That from nowhere all over the world, if there be no sweet savor unto God from this place and from this region, from this gathering, God will smell a sweet savor. Something that he will not make him to be happy. When God destroyed the world in the time of Noah, and Noah's ark settled on the Mount Ararat, and Noah came out, the Bible says, from that single spot, all over the world, as wide as the world was, from that single spot, altar was raised, and God smelled a sweet savor. Even though God wanted from every corner of the earth for a sweet savor to rise up to the throne, but they disappointed God. And God destroyed all of them, and from that single spot, at least there was a single spot. How I pray that your life will be that single spot. That your life, my sister and my brother, will be that single spot when the offering, the sweet-smelling savor of God will flow up to heaven, and God will smell, and he will say, that's my daughter, that's my son, in whom I'm well pleased. We read something in Nehemiah about the leaders of Tekoa in Nehemiah chapter 3. Nehemiah chapter 3. Nehemiah chapter 3 and verse 5. And next unto them, the Tekoites repaired. For their nobles, their kings, their princes, their dignified men, their chairmen, their highly placed people, put not their necks to the work of their Lord. Here was work to be done. The tribes were building the wall of Jerusalem that had been pulled down. And Nehemiah gathered all the tribes together. And by family, they were building different parts of the wall. And Nehemiah called all the Tekoites together. They were a family. And Tekoites, you will repair these parts of the wall. And they all said, okay. And immediately Nehemiah turned back and went away. The nobles of Tekoa said, I'm sorry. I think I'm too dignified for more than this kind of work. I think I cannot condescend to this kind of... See the garment I'm wearing. Can't you see noble garment on my body? All you ordinary Tekoites, you go ahead and build. All you normal people, the plebeians, the down to earth people, you go ahead and build. As for us, we are nobles. As for us, we are dignified. As for us, we are leaders. As for us, we are highly placed people. We cannot put our necks to the work of the Lord. But the Bible says that the ordinary Tekoites, they repaired. While their leaders and their nobles were saying, no, we're not going to do it. Ordinary Tekoites said, we are going to do it. And they did it. And I saw something beautiful again. They did it again and again. Look at verse 27. After them, the Tekoites repaired another piece. They said, well, you are our nobles. You say you won't do it. Okay. Well, we'll do our own part. After we are finished, they said, any more work, Nehemiah? And Nehemiah gave them another place again. And check your Bible well. That was the only family that built two places. Oh, they said, well, our nobles will not do it. We will do it. They won't do it once. We will do it twice. They won't so much as touch the work with their hands. We will carry the work on our heads. Brethren, when all these nobles of Tekoa refused to put their necks to the work of their Lord, then ordinary Tekoites did it again and again. Let's therefore resolve, like the nobles of Tekoa, that we will go forward. While the nobles of the church, while the dignified of the church, while the well-placed in the church, while the creme de la creme of the church refuse to make progress and they say, we will not put our necks to the work of their Lord. Let's not go like them. Let's not be like them. Let's be like ordinary techwives. Whatever name they call us, region overseer, location pastor, district pastor, whatever name we are called, let's forget about all that. Let's put our necks onto the work of our Lord. And God will write it down for us as a memorial, that I know a people, not preeminent in name, but preeminent in service. I know a people, not preeminent in all the show, but preeminent for one thing. They are preeminent in obedience to their Lord, preeminent in faithfulness, and in love for the Master. Let us all resolve that all the purity which can be had on this side of eternity, we will have it. And let's all resolve that all the sanctity which can be purchased, which can be obtained, we will obtain. Let's all make up our minds that all the likeness to Christ, all the image of Christ that is possible in this world of sin to obtain shall certainly be our own. So that through the work of the Spirit of God will be a perfect, completed lamb. We have come here to move forward. And I charge you in the name of the Lord, move forward. I charge you by the Spirit of God. I charge you because of the calling. And I charge you by the anointing. And I charge you by all the fiber in my being. I charge you by the commitment and my calling over you as your pastor to go forward. And let us all tonight start here and now. And let's all resolve that these 4 days we are going to do something. In 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 24, the Shunammite woman was in dire straits. She was in an emergency. And she wanted the servant to carry her to a particular place where the man of God was. And she called the husband. She said, husband, send me an ass. And then the ass came. A servant was riding the ass. And the woman climbed the ass. And this is the statement that she made. And this is the statement we all need to make tonight. And throughout these 4 days, to the Spirit of the Lord. Listen, the Shunammite woman made that statement to her servant. We are making that statement to our Master. She made that statement with all pomposity because she was a master over that man. We make all that statement with all humility and sobriety because we are appealing to our Lord and our Commissioner, the Holy Ghost Himself who has put us in the work. She made all that calling as a woman desperately in need. We make that calling as men and women desperately in need. And she told her servant, drive, go forward. Drive, go forward. Slap the not thy riding for me, except I bid thee. Bread of heaven, fill me till I want no more. Fill me till I want no more. Bread of heaven, feed your church until we want no more. The woman said, drive, go forward. Don't slap your riding for me. Why don't you rise up now? Say the same thing to the Spirit of the Lord. Drive and go forward. Oh, Spirit of the Lord, push me ahead. Leave me not behind and let me go forward because I come here to go forward. Drive and go forward. Drive and go forward. He says, drive. He says, go forward. Slap not thy riding for me except I bid thee. We have come to make progress. We have come to go forward. We have come to go forward. Oh, may the Spirit of the Lord charge his church. May the Spirit of the Lord visit his church. May the Spirit of the Lord walk in his church. Oh, Spirit Divine, blessed Holy Ghost, the third person of the Godhead. Oh, God, our Master and our Lord, drive and go forward. Slack not your riding for your church. Drive your church forward. Push us ahead. Help us to go forward. Help us to make progress. We all are dying for your hand. We are dying for your hand. We are dying for your blessing. We are dying, oh Lord, that you will touch us. Oh, Lord, help us to drive. To go forward. Go forward in all grace, in all gifts, in prayer, in the word, in our lives, in everything we have come to do. Oh, Lord, I pray. Drive and go forward. Slack not thy riding for us. Unless we bid thee, Lord, and we are not going to bid thee today, we will not bid you tomorrow, we will not bid you the following day, we will not bid you until we finish it. 3-4 days here. Oh Lord, drive and go forward. Push us forward. Drive us forward. Send us forward. Propel us forward. Let your church be on the move, oh Lord. Let your church be on the move. Let the Holy Ghost send a fire upon our hearts. Let him ignite us with the flame from off the altar. Let him set us on fire. Let all this church be ignited like Samson's foxes. Oh Lord, drive and go forward. Slack not your riding for us. Drive us, oh Lord, and push us to your place.